On April 23rd of 2018, at approximately 1:20 p.m., the city of Toronto witnessed the worst mass murder in its history, as 25-year-old Alec Manassian was seen on CCTV, speeding down the sidewalks in a rental van, cutting down each and every soul in his deadly path. 10 people lost their lives. 16 others were severely maimed. His vehicle eventually came to a halt, at which point he was arrested at gunpoint. He was then brought to a Toronto police station and subjected to interrogation 9 hours later.
And you can just have a seat in the corner right over there, okay?
Okay.
Just have a seat right there, please. Thanks very much.
Hello.
Hi, how are you?
I'm good, how are you?
Good, good. Did you drink water?
Sure.
Thank you very much. Thanks so much. How are you feeling?
I'm good.
You're feeling okay? My name's Rob Thomas.
Nice to meet you.
Hi, how are you? How are you? You doing okay?
Yeah.
Yeah, you probably had better days than this, I guess, eh?
Yeah.
Well, I am a little shaken, to be honest.
A little shaken?
It's not, it's not my usual day, obviously.
These eerily literal and matter-of-fact responses will be continuous throughout this interrogation. You will not see a shred of remorse, nor a single attempt to mask the horror of what he had done just hours before. He is diagnosed with Asperger syndrome, yet comes across far more sinister than the average person with the condition. An unfortunate myth about the disorder is that diagnosed individuals have no emotions whatsoever, which is simply not the case. They can have a harder time identifying and fully expressing their emotions, yet most are able to do so to a certain degree. Being autistic doesn't mean you are at greater risk of evil deeds. If this character didn't have Asperger's, his moral compass would still be corrupt and would still be void of empathy for the victims, but more able to fake empathy for his own self-preservation.
Yeah, no, I can appreciate that. Alec, do you mind if I call you Alec?
Yeah, sure.
Is it, what do your friends normally call you?
Alec.
Alec, my name's Rob Thomas. So I want you to call me Rob from here on in, okay?
Okay.
Is that okay?
Okay.
The reason for the detective's friendly disposition is self-explanatory. It will allow for the development of rapport, thus making the suspect more likely to open up to questioning. Yet one might wonder why further information is even needed at this point. After all, the evidence they already had on the suspect was conclusive. He was without question the culprit. Yet when a crime is so heinous and abnormal, an appeal for insanity is always a strong solicitation from a defense team. Yet if the detective can establish a motive, it can be used to refute it. And the more detailed and clear-cut the motive, the stronger the state's case will be against him, and establishing this motive will be the priority for the detective throughout this interrogation. It's just a case of building a strong enough connection with a suspect to allow him to divulge it. He needs to feel safe and trust the man he is speaking with.
Alec, I want you to understand something. I'm a senior detective with the Toronto Police. Do you understand what that means?
Yes.
Now, here's what I want to do, Alec. I want to talk to you, okay? We're going to spend a good deal of time together, okay?
Uh-huh.
It's important that I talk to you, all right? I'm going to ask you questions, okay? I'm going to ask you questions about your background, your education, your relationships with your family and friends, work, travel. And I'm gonna ask you questions about what happened today. Okay? You don't have to answer those questions if you don't want. If you do decide to answer my questions, would you do me the favor and just speak from the heart? Okay? And just be truthful. That's all I ask. Does that sound fair?
Yes.
Is that okay? Okay. Now, my understanding is, earlier today, there was an incident, and you ultimately got arrested by a police officer. Do you remember that?
I do remember getting arrested.
Okay. Do you remember it was a uniformed police officer who arrested you? So in other words, he was a police officer in a uniform?
Yes, I remember he had a uniform.
Yeah, okay. And I know there was a bit of an altercation. We'll get into that. But basically, I just want to kind of cover off a few points before we get started. My understanding is that that incident, the time that you got arrested, you were on or near the area of Yonge Street earlier today. Is that right? And a police officer told you that you were going to be placed under arrest. And he placed you under arrest. Do you remember that?
I remember that.
Okay. Do you remember what he arrested you for?
I believe I may have been arrested for something similar to murder.
He carefully avoids defining his actions as murder, and the reasoning behind this will be revealed later on.
Okay. I believe it was originally you were arrested for attempted murder, and subsequent to that, the officer placed you in handcuffs. Is that right?
Yes.
Do you remember that?
Yeah, now I remember that.
Do you remember the officer reading you that?
To be honest, I encountered various police officers. I don't remember which one read me that.
Okay, all right. But nevertheless, you were read. We call that a caution. You were read that caution.
Yes, actually, now that you mentioned the word caution, I do remember hearing the words of primary caution and secondary caution.
Okay, great. That's interesting, because not a lot of people can remember those words. Okay, so that's what I read you is what we refer to as a primary caution. Now, in addition to that, I just want to clarify one more thing. Did you speak to the police and tell them what happened today?
Sorry, I'm just need a minute to think about that. Are you asking if I in any way confessed?
Well, I'm asking if you confessed or if you made a statement at all to any other police officer.
I never made any significant statement about any events that occurred before I was arrested.
Great. Okay, so if you did have any conversation with any police officer prior to being brought into this room, all right? And that includes making a statement or a confession, okay? I want you to ignore what you've said, okay? And I don't want you to refer back to that conversation, okay? And what I mean by referring back, I don't want you to tell me about any conversations you've had with any other police officers,
okay? Okay.
What I'd like to do is start fresh. We call this a clean slate.
Okay.
So from here on in, okay, I want this to be a fresh start.
Okay.
Does that make sense?
Yes.
The investigator goes through each sequence of events from the suspect's arrest to his arrival at the police station, as well as each of the charges laid against him. This is essentially making sure the suspect is fit to be interrogated, and further establishing that he understands his level of jeopardy. All of these steps are emphasized when the suspect has any type of developmental disorder or psychiatric impairment. The investigator needs to remove any slight possibility that a defense team could use to argue unjust or improper practice.
Understanding is you were taken to the cell area?
Yes.
Okay, and you were placed in a cell. And my understanding is that cell has a bathroom. Has a toilet.
Yes.
It has a toilet and a sink.
Yes.
And then following that, now there were a couple of other events that are important. One was, my understanding is you were given an opportunity to speak to a lawyer.
Yes.
Okay. And you indicated to the officers that you didn't have a lawyer.
Correct.
And that you didn't know who to call.
Correct.
And so the officers offered you an opportunity to speak to duty counsel, which is that free legal service that I talked about.
Correct.
Okay. And my understanding is you spoke to duty counsel.
Correct.
Okay. And you did that in private, is that right?
Correct.
In other words, there wasn't anybody listening to your conversation?
Correct.
Okay. Now, I don't want you to tell me what the lawyer said, but did you understand what the lawyer was telling you?
Yes.
Okay. Are you satisfied with the information that he told you?
Yes.
Okay. So my understanding is, as the night progressed and as we were learning more information, it came to our attention that nine people have died, I apologize. As a result of an incident that occurred on Yonge Street. And so subsequent to that, my understanding is the officers came down and they spoke to you to advise you that the charges would be upgraded to 9 counts of first-degree murder. Do you understand what first-degree murder is?
It's a premeditated murder and completely intentional and considered to be what's known as in cold blood.
Well, yeah, that's a fairly, precise way of describing it. What we call it premeditated. It means premeditated. You understand what premeditated means?
Yes, it would mean that someone planned for that murder in advance.
Right, planning and deliberation. In other words, if somebody committed first degree murder, they would have took the time out to think about what they were going to do. Sit down and deliberate over the plan. So in other words, they were going to sit down and go over the details of the plan, figure out what it is they were going to do, how they were going to execute the plan, and so on and so forth, to commit a murder. Plan and deliberate. That's what it means. So there's a lot of thought and energy that goes into planning to kill somebody. That's what first degree murder is. You're going to be charged with 10 counts of first degree murder, okay? As well as 15 counts of attempted murder. I've read you your rights to counsel, your caution, secondary caution, and so forth. Do you wish to speak to a lawyer? The choice is yours.
Yes, I will speak to a lawyer.
You want to speak to a lawyer?
Yes, please.
Okay. Did you have a lawyer, or did you want to speak to duty counsel?
I'd like to speak to duty counsel, please.
Okay, no problem. So can you just hold on? Can you sit tight for 1 second? I'm just going to just exit the room here for 1 minute. So, before we go any further, just tell me what happened from the time we left this room until the time we came back. What took place?
My lawyer told me not to answer.
Okay.
Due process was given to the suspect upon the request of legal counsel, and as expected, he was advised to remain silent. Yet this doesn't mean authorities are legally obligated to stop the questioning process once the suspect is briefed. Although the suspect has been advised to remain silent, Detective Thomas will have lost no confidence with regard to the primary objective.
I understand that, okay, and I'm glad you told me that. You know why? Because that tells me you understand what your rights are, okay? But you need to understand something, okay? We, the police, have a job to do, okay? And that job includes collecting evidence, speaking to people, trying to understand and uncover what's happened, what took place. And asking questions, and we're obligated to sit down and speak to people like yourself who are in this position and ask you questions, all right? Your lawyer's right, you don't have to answer any questions, okay? But you need to understand something, Alec, okay? I still have to ask you questions, okay? And I'm going to ask you questions, all right? And I'm going to talk, okay? And it's not, I'm not doing that to make you feel intimidated or to make you scared or to say things that you don't want to hear, okay? But the bottom line is, we have a very difficult job to do, okay? And this is a very, very important matter that we're dealing with here today, all right? So, I'm going to ask you questions. If you don't want to answer them, you can tell me you don't want to answer them. Or you don't have to say anything at all. I totally understand that. As long as we can still maintain that respect that we talked about at the beginning, is that cool?
Yes.
Is that cool? You're not going to offend me, okay? You're not going to make me upset or insult me if you say, Rob, I don't want to answer that question, okay?
The detective recounts the events that occurred from the time they last left the room to the time they returned.
If I'm not mistaken, the officers fed you, is that right?
Yes.
Downstairs in the cells?
Yes.
What did they feed you?
He then poses the first open-ended question, a question that cannot be answered with a yes or no response.
Sandwich and juice.
A sandwich and a juice, okay.
This may seem inconsequential, yet it's a fairly significant breakthrough. The suspect has already unintentionally gone against his lawyer's advice, which would have been to only respond with yes, no, or I don't wish to answer, and only to questions not related to the crime. If he is capable of making a slip-up this early on, it lets the detective know he will be likely to make a more serious error later on when he encounters more incriminating questions. The strategy will now focus on the development of rapport while slowly and subtly shifting the dialogue from trivial matters to the actual circumstances related to the crime.
What was that?
I didn't have access to the time at the time I was fed.
Okay. Are you hungry?
No.
Okay. Did you have anything else to eat today?
I ate before I was arrested.
Okay. And what time was that?
I don't recall.
Okay. Do you remember what you ate?
I don't recall.
Okay. All right. If you're hungry at all, at any point in time, you just let me know.
Okay.
If you need to borrow the washroom, you just let me know. Okay. I'm going to leave that up to you to tell me. Okay, because I'm not going to know if you're hungry or not. I'm not going to know if you need to go to the washroom. So I'm going to rely on you to tell me that. Is that cool?
Yes.
All right. How much sleep did you have last night?
About 8 hours.
About 8 hours. And how did you sleep?
I slept well.
You slept well. And where did you sleep? Was it your home?
I do not wish to answer that.
Okay. All right. Nevertheless, you slept well. Okay. I want to ask you something, Alec, and this is important. Are you on any kind of medication right now?
No.
Okay, so do you take any, what I mean by medication, do you take anything prescribed for any physical injuries or ailments of any type?
I don't wish to answer that.
Okay. What about medication for psychological issues?
I don't wish to answer that.
Okay. Alec, can I ask you this? Because it's important. And I'm saying this because I think I know the answer, but am I wrong to understand that in high school you were identified as someone with special needs?
I don't wish to answer that.
Okay. How are things at home?
Good.
With you and your family?
Yes.
Are you close to your mom and dad?
Yes.
Yeah? And what about your relationship with your brother?
It's good.
Mm-hmm. I understand you were born in Canada.
Yes.
Yeah, and your parents immigrated to Canada some time ago. And they're originally from Iraq, is that right?
I do not wish to confirm or deny that.
Okay, all right, okay. I just say that because I've spoken to your dad. And he's worried about you. I'll tell you that. Okay.
The investigator evokes the sentimental thought of the suspect's father being worried about him. It's designed to conjure an emotional feeling in his mind.
And I ask you these questions, and I'm not trying to intimidate you. I'm not trying to scare you. Okay.
The emotional conception of his father's concern is then interlinked with the immediate questioning process taking place. There is no given explanation of any resemblance or connection between the two elements, yet the intimate thought of his father has now been subjectively merged with the detective. It's a subliminal and also very subtle attempt to build trust. A simple way of putting it would be that the investigator is trying to develop a father-figure connection with the suspect, and then use the assurance of a father figure to extract information. You also start to see the detective use terminology and parlance associated with parenthood.
The reason why I ask these questions is because it's important that I get to know you better, all right? We just met for the very first time, and you don't know me, am I right?
Correct.
Right. And I've never met you before, but I do know a great deal about you. And it's important I get to know you better. And the reason why I say that is because this is an important issue that brings you here today, okay? It's very serious. And I think I would be neglectful if I didn't at least try and understand who you are. That's all I'm trying to do. Do you understand?
Yes.
Does that make sense?
Yes.
Okay. Do you feel intimidated right now? Are you scared or anything like that?
No.
Okay. Will you let me know if that ever happens?
I will let you know.
Okay. All right. My understanding is you were in a special needs class in high school. Okay. In my conversation with you, in my experience with people with special needs, because I've been doing this a long time, and I have actually family members who have special needs. Because of a variety of different reasons. I can recognize people who, who have special needs. And so the reason why I'm saying that is because I want to make sure you understand what I'm saying, okay? I don't want to be saying something that is going to confuse you or make you feel uncomfortable or make you feel scared. Does that make sense?
Yes.
Okay.
Are you in any kind of relationship right now with
an intimate partner? I mean, do you have a girlfriend or a...
I do not wish to answer that.
You know? Okay. All right. What about friends? Do you have a group of friends that you typically hang around with?
I do not wish to answer that.
Am I to understand that you've had some military experience in the past?
Yes.
Yeah, okay. Was it in Canada? I'm
assuming? Yes.
Yeah. And my dad was in the military. Did you have a particular skill that you wanted to develop, or was it just...
I was interested in learning how to use weapons.
Beautiful. Okay.
Specifically large guns. Unfortunately, I never made it far enough in my basic training to use guns, so I don't know what type of guns the military uses.
Oh, okay. Do you find yourself playing? Do you play a lot of video games? A guy like you, 25 years old, imagine you're...
Yeah, I actually like playing video games, especially the violent ones.
The violent ones, yeah.
I just like to let out all my urges into the TV screen.
That's why they're there, right? So as far as being a gamer, how would you classify yourself? Are you like a
big classify myself as a hardcore gamer.
Hardcore gamer. So in terms of hours spent during the day playing video games, how often would you? How many hours would you spend?
I would say an average of 5 hours per day.
My understanding is you're living at home. You don't live on your own. Am I right?
I don't wish to answer that.
Okay. But you have a good relationship with your mom and dad?
Yes.
Yeah. And has your relationship always been good with your mom and dad?
Yes.
Okay. And have they been supportive and loving throughout your life?
Yes.
And were there any difficulties in your life growing up with your mom and dad?
No.
No. What about with school? Were there difficulties with school growing up?
No.
No? And so when I talk about that, I'm talking about like the school curriculum, you know, going to school, learning, and completing your assignments and things like that. Were there any issues?
No.
Okay. What about the students?
No, I never had any issues.
Never had any issue with any of the students or anything
No.
like that? No. And I say this because, you know, sometimes these things are important. How were you treated by the other students?
I was treated well.
You treated well, okay. Did you have any difficulties with any particular group of students?
No.
No. What about difficulties with girls in particular?
No.
No difficulties with girls at all?
No.
No, not at all. How do you feel about girls in general?
I'm attracted to them.
Oh, you are? Okay. So you're heterosexual?
Yes.
Would it be fair to say that? Okay, that's important. Have you ever had a relationship with a female?
I don't wish to answer that.
Okay, all right. In terms of females, I mean females and women, because you're 25, you're a young man, right? We'll call them women. In terms of your feelings towards women in general, how would you describe that?
I would say that sometimes I am a bit upset that they choose to date obnoxious men instead of gentlemen.
Yeah. So my understanding is you have some problems with women who date obnoxious men. Right?
Yes.
And these guys, I'm thinking you're talking about the fellows who are loud, arrogant, generally outgoing, and popular with girls.
Yes.
Is that what you're talking about?
Yes.
Okay. And you have a problem with the women that date these fellas?
Yes.
Why is it that you have a problem with the women?
Because I feel that it's illogical to be dating such men when they could be dating gentlemen instead.
Right. That makes sense. I mean, and I've seen that because I've grown up. And I'll tell you one of the issues that I had as a kid growing up, because I was, this is going to say, you might not believe me, but believe, I wasn't a very big kid growing up. I was actually very, very small. And it took me a long time to grow. And so as a result, I was kind of ostracized. You know what I mean by ostracized? I was kind of
cast aside.
Cast aside, yeah, yeah. And I left out, like I wouldn't get picked for teams, you know, or anything like that. You know, I was always kind of the last guy. Yeah, you ever see those television shows where, you know, all the kids are lined up and they're getting picked for, you know, the teams, and there's always one guy left out at the end?
Yeah.
That was me. I was that guy. And I was never very popular with women, girls in school. And that kind of actually went on through to early part of my adulthood until I started, you know, getting taller and maturing, right? But I understand exactly what you meant, because I was, as a kid growing up, I was, I was like any other kid, any other young man, right? You would look at attractive girls, and I knew I was probably just as smart, if not smarter, than some of the clowns they were dating. But because, for whatever reason, I didn't have what it took, they wouldn't date me. Because I think because I was short, they wouldn't date me, and they'd end up dating, you know, the tall jocks and the other, you know, the good-looking fellows. Is that what you're talking about?
Yes.
Yeah, then you kind of resent these girls, right?
Yeah.
Because, you know, that's kind of a superficial way of deciding, you know, who it is.
Because
you're gonna
height get. Is an unfair, you can't control your height.
This is the first time the suspect added his own input to a topic without being asked a question first. It's a sign that he is beginning to develop trust, and the investigator now maintains this development by focusing on the detail that made him open up.
Right, exactly. Right. What other things can't you control?
You can't control your looks either.
Exactly. Yeah, that's a good point. Although you're not a bad-looking guy.
Thank you.
No, you are. You're a good-looking guy. You know, you keep yourself well, and you're good. You're fit. You know, you're tall. Yeah. What other things can you control?
I'm not aware of anything else you can't control.
What about physical disabilities? Right. Obviously, if you were blind, or you know.
Unfortunately, you can't control that.
Yeah, you can't control that. That's what I mean. So these are things you can't control, or you know, other disabilities. You know, if you're mentally handicapped, or if you you have an amputee, or you know, there's other things. And so does that, would you include that in those issues that you can't control?
Yes.
And so how long have you had this this feeling towards women who are attracted to, you know, this particular type of guy?
Ever since I started college.
Ever since you started college, okay. Was it something that occurred as a result of a single incident? Like, was there one particular moment in your life where it sort of struck home, this was a problem, or was it just a...
A broad outline of a motive has essentially been identified for the crime, and the detective is now trying to zero in on particulars. The more detail he can get from the suspect about his established motive, the more incriminating it will be in a court of law.
On Halloween of 2013, I was attending a house party, mm-hmm. and I walked in and attempted to socialize with some girls. However, they all laughed at me and held the arms of the big guys instead.
Really?
Yeah.
Well, that's kind of rude. And how did that make you feel?
I felt very angry.
Yeah. Anger and resentment, the underlying causes for revenge. The reason the legally insane are given leniency is because they are deemed incapable of these complex and multi-layered emotions, thus incapable of acting with evil intent. Their criminal infractions will have no reason or purpose. Yet the suspect has now admitted to quenching the hostility he felt from rejection by inflicting pain and suffering on others.
Yet they would, because I considered myself a supreme gentleman, I was angry that they would give their love and affection to obnoxious brutes.
Really. And so it was at that particular moment, and that was sort of the defining moment that made you think that, you know, this is wrong, and you know, these people are,
yes,
are unfairly treating you in the way that they were?
Yes.
Yeah, yeah. And that makes sense. I appreciate you telling me that. That says a lot. And so from that point on, what did you start doing?
I started thinking that it's unfair that certain guys will not get any love and affection from girls.
This is why the word incel is so heavily associated with entitlement. If you're a normal human being, you might feel lonely when you're not getting love and affection, but not enraged. If you think you are entitled to love and affection, when you don't get it, anger and resentment will likely arise.
Okay. What do you mean by certain guys?
Such as me, that are very nice and act gentlemanly.
Right. Are there other guys? Did you find other guys are in the same?
There, I know of several other guys over the internet who feel the same way, but I know they are, I would consider them too cowardly to act on their anger.
Oh, okay. And so on the internet, what are you talking about in terms of?
Specifically certain boards on 4chan.
Oh, okay, 4chan. I'm familiar with 4chan. Right, so 4chan is a website, and within 4chan there are these messaging boards.
Yes.
And they're individual boards specific to like-minded people.
Yes.
So when did you first start going on to 4chan?
Since 2014.
Oh, okay. All right. And how did you learn about 4chan?
I was informed about it by a friend at college.
Oh, okay. All right. And was he on it as well? Or?
Yes.
Okay. What's his name?
I don't wish to answer.
Okay. I understand. What's the general the topic within these message boards?
Well, on B, the or random, the general topic is random. It's literally any random topic.
Mm-hmm.
On R9K, it's they call us space robots.
Okay.
The topic is usually frustrations at an inability to lose one's virginity, specifically for young males.
Okay.
Poll, which is politically incorrect, mm-hmm. is the general topic is basically political discussions with an alt-right bias.
Political discussions with an alt-right. So you're ultra-conservative, or you're,
yes.
you're like a, you know, in the American definition, you'd be you know, ultra-Republican.
Yes.
Okay. So you, what would your what would your political views be in the alt-right message board?
I actually don't have any political views. I only the only reason I have talked with them was just because I enjoyed their style of conversation.
Okay. And what was the style of conversation?
It was very blunt and honest.
So when what would it be? What would it typically focus around, or what would the typical conversations contain?
Red pill truths about why women choose to date obnoxious men.
Date the Chads.
Yeah.
The Chads of this world.
Yeah. Basically, the Stacey's going for the Chads.
Exactly. The Stacey's are the dizzy dumb girls dating the goofy, you know, jocks.
Yeah.
Right. So you call them Stacey's and Chads.
Yeah.
I've heard that term before. I've done a little bit of reading, and I know a little bit about involuntary
celibacy.
Celibacy, right. So being celibate, involuntarily
yes.
celibate. What does that mean?
That means celibacy means someone who never has a sexual intercourse.
Right.
Involuntary celibacy means this wasn't your choice. Essentially have been thrown into true forced loneliness and you're unable to lose your virginity.
Right.
This is especially painful for young males.
When did you first, sorry, you mentioned this and I forgot. When did you first go on to 4chan?
2014.
And specifically when, in 2014?
May 23, 2014.
How are you able to remember that?
Because I remember that was a very significant day.
Okay. What was that?
That was when Elliot Rodger decided to essentially commit an uprising, a beta uprising, if you will,
right.
against the Chads and the Stacey's.
Okay. And that was in the United States?
Yes.
So explain to me this movement. What's this movement about?
It's basically a movement of angry incels such as myself who are unable to get laid. Therefore, we want to overthrow the Chads, mm-hmm. which would force the Stacys to be forced to reproduce with the incels.
Right. Okay. When you say incels,
involuntary celibate.
Celibate. So that's just a short form for fellas who
can't get laid.
Can't have sex. Right. Okay. And what happened in the Elliot Rodgers uprising? What did he do?
I know he used a gun as well as a vehicle to convert the life status of certain individuals to death status.
Right.
Only to carry the message that incels can't be oppressed.
Right. So it was an act of rebellion.
Yes.
And out of frustration and anger.
You could call it an incel rebellion.
Incel rebellion, exactly. Right, yeah. Okay. So what did you discuss with these guys?
We discussed our frustrations at society and being unable to get laid. And we were plotting a certain timed strikes mm-hmm. on society in order to confuse and shake the foundations, just to put all the normies in a state of panic.
Okay, and who would be a normie?
Normie means normal people. That would be anyone who is considered to be normal by the unfair standards of society.
But not the Chads or Stacys.
Chads and Stacys are actually above normies, or at least they think they're above normies.
Of course, yeah. Okay, all right. So is it fair to say you've got Chads and Stacys up here, normies down here? And then you've got celebs who believe that they are being
incels. Yes.
Incels who believe they're being suppressed or repressed, yes. and so as a result, even the playing field.
Yes.
They convert the Stacys and Chads from living to dead, and to
so
make
that we come out on top.
Yeah. More than so. Is there so the targets? Who are the targets for this uprising be?
All of the alpha males.
All the alpha males, so the Chads.
Yes.
So those are the people that you want to kill?
Yes.
Okay, all right. And who else?
Any of the Stacys who do not wish to give their love and affection to the incels.
So they're a target as well?
Yes.
To be killed?
Yes.
Okay, and what about the normies? Normies.
Yes, we don't necessarily wish to kill the normies, but we do wish to subjugate them in order to make them understand that that our type is the more superior one.
Right. So when you say subjugate, what do you mean by that?
Meaning either imprison them or put them in a lower position in society.
Okay.
So that they acknowledge the incels or the Pepe the Frog types as the more superior ones.
You're saying things that I'm not familiar with.
Sorry.
What's a Pepe the Frog?
He's a mascot on 4chan.
He's a mascot?
Yes.
Oh, mascot on 4chan.
Yes. I was using a metaphor.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, so he's actually worshipped quite frequently.
Oh, okay. Who did you have conversation with first? Let me ask you that.
Elliot.
So how did you learn of Elliot?
Because we private messaged each other on Reddit,
yep.
after I saw one of his posts,
mm-hmm.
We just talked about each other, got to know each other, and we found each other very interesting. We both had the same frustrations at society,
right.
despite being separated by distance so far apart.
Right. Did you ever visit him?
No, but I wish I could have.
Yeah. Did he ever come and visit you?
No, but I wish he did.
Yeah. When specifically did you first contact or have contact with Elliot?
January of 2014.
And when did you stop having communication with him?
As soon as he was deceased.
Okay. So his act, I know, took place in 2014, but I wasn't aware of the exact day. What day was it?
May 23, 2014.
May 23rd. Yeah, you said that. So when did you last speak to him?
May 20.
May 20th. And so what did he tell you?
He told me that he has to go. He is on a very important mission, mm-hmm. and he might not make it back alive. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. And so what did you say to him?
I kind of had an idea in my head of what he was planning, but I didn't want to think it was true at the time. So I replied and said, I wish you good luck with that.
Right on. Okay. And so you last speak to him on March 20th.
May 20th,
2014.
Yes.
He commits his acts on the 23rd of May.
Yes.
And when did you learn that what he had done?
I saw it on the news later that night.
Later on the 23rd?
Yes.
Okay. And what did you think?
I thought that I came to the understanding that this is the mission that he had to carry out.
Okay. All right. And anything else?
I felt kind of proud of him for his acts of bravery.
Okay. All right. And what about how you started to change your thinking? Was any of that going on?
I was starting to feel radicalized at that time.
You were. Okay. And when you say radicalized, what do you mean by that?
Meaning I felt it was time to take action and not just sit on the sidelines and just fester in my own sadness.
Right on. Okay. So what takes place next as part of this growing radicalization?
To be honest, the planning didn't occur until about a month ago. Most of it was actually just thinking and daydreaming.
Okay, all right. So the thinking and daydreaming, when did that start?
That started about a month after the rebellion in May of 2014.
Okay, so...
So in June, I started thinking about this stuff.
And then that continued right up till about a month ago?
Yes, which is when I booked the van with the rider in order to use as a tool for rebellion.
Okay, all right. So take me through that process. What was going through your mind and how was, you know, what were you thinking when you were doing all of this? What was going on?
I was thinking that it was a time that I stood up to the Chads and Stacys.
Okay. And then, so what happened? Tell me what takes place.
So I booked the van.
Yeah.
And then I just simply wait until today.
Yeah.
And then I go rent the van, and then I drive it, take it downtown to Toronto.
Okay.
And I just start using it as a weapon.
Okay. All right. And so when you say that, what do you mean by that?
Meaning the vehicle collided with several pedestrians, some of who are no longer alive as a result.
Right. Okay. Can I ask, why were you looking specifically for a truck?
Because it would be large enough to inflict severe damage.
Okay, that makes sense. And in this thinking, what were you thinking specifically?
About how the foundations of the world would be shaken by this event.
Okay. And when you say that, what do you mean by the foundations of this world?
Meaning that I was fairly confident that others would be inspired to repeat the same actions as me, in basically just to overthrow society.
Okay. Now, what are you thinking while you're in the van?
I'm thinking that this is it. This is the day of retribution.
Okay. And anything else in your mind?
Just that. That's the only thing that's in my mind. It's just burning in my mind.
Burning in your mind.
Yeah. I'm thinking that this is it. I see all these people. It's time to go for it.
Time to go for it. And what do you do?
I floor the pedal.
Yeah.
I speed the van towards them, and I allow the van to collide with them.
Okay. And then what happens?
Some people get knocked out of the way. Some people roll over the top of the van.
Okay. And then what happens?
I continue doing that until
In fact, to be honest, the only reason I stopped my attack was because someone's drink got splashed on my windshield, and I was worried that I would crash the van anyway, so I decided, okay, now I wanted to do more, but I've kind of been foiled by a lack of visibility. So then that's when I turned right, and I saw the cops approaching, so I decided to pull over and get out of my van.
Okay.
His analytical and strategic preparation for the attack, and the attentive precautions he took for each step, shows an individual with a visibly corrupt, yet undeniably balanced mind. He is not insane, and what the detective has got him to divulge in the last hour of this interrogation will prove that in a court of law.
I see a patrol car pull over, and I hear the cop screaming at me to get out, so I get out, and I point my wallet at the cop with the intent for it to be confused at the gun so that I could be fatally shot.
Okay. And was that something you were thinking about?
Yes.
What I'm saying is, even
beforehand, I premeditated as an attempted suicide by cop.
You wanted to be killed by the police?
Yes.
Okay.
Suicidal tendencies are by no means enough to prove insanity on their own, but they can be used to argue detachment from oneself. If a defense team can prove that the defendant's self-interest were of no concern to himself, they can also lessen the perception of wickedness with relation to the lack of concern that he had for others. The detective will now attempt to garner information that the suspect, in reality, did not intend to die that day.
Can I ask why you decided to equip yourself with a wallet and not something else?
I was worried, I was thinking about purchasing a toy gun,
right,
but I was kind of paranoid that for whatever reason, the rental company would ask to see my pockets or any bag if I chose to bring that, so I decided to go as stealthy as possible so no one suspects anything.
Okay, all right.
The prosecution during his trial will most likely argue that he could have picked up the van first and then retrieved a toy gun afterwards.
Nevertheless, you get out of the van, the officer, correct me if I'm wrong, because I want to make sure I get this right. You get out of the van because the officer orders you out?
Yes.
Okay.
He was ordered out of the van at gunpoint. Had he hit the gas at that moment, he would have most likely been shot, and the prosecution can argue that he was in fear of that happening, which is why he complied with the orders.
And you want to die by suicide by police? So you point your wallet at him?
Yes.
Okay, and do you say anything to the officer?
I actually told him that I had a gun in my pocket, which was untrue.
Right.
Then I stuck my left hand in my pocket and attempted to do this just to provoke a reaction.
Okay.
Unfortunately, he didn't react,
right.
So then I ended up being ordered to the ground. So I knew at that point, he's not going to shoot me, so I've lost. So I had no choice but to just get on the ground.
Okay, so just walk me through this step-by-step, because I'm a little confused. So you get out of the van, you turn right, you can't see, you hear the police, you know they're coming, you see the police officer approach, you stop your vehicle, you realize this is the end. He orders you out, you get out of the van.
Yes.
Now, your plan was to die by suicide by cop. So you said you reached into your pocket twice.
Originally, the entire time I was holding my wallet with my right hand, but then when I saw that wasn't working, I reached into my pocket with my left hand and quickly pulled it out and formed my hand into the shape of a gun like this.
Okay.
With the hope that he would panic and shoot me. That, of course, didn't happen.
This entire incident was captured on video. These were the two motions that the suspect alleged were for the purpose of provoking a lethal response. They seem convincing, yet notice where the cop was looking and where his gun was pointed at that moment. eyes looking to the right, away from the suspect, and weapon pointed towards the ground. The assailant most likely knew he wasn't going to be shot. The police officer was on his own, and was incredibly brave to initially confront the suspect without backup. Yet at this moment, he's assessed the threat and recognized there is no need to use deadly force. He wouldn't have taken his eyes off the attacker for even 1 second otherwise. This is further established by the fact that he takes his time to turn off the siren to try and de-escalate the situation. The police officer holsters his pistol and takes out his baton to avoid the use of unnecessary lethal force. As soon as he takes his advancing first step, the assailant immediately gives up. The assailant, who had just purposely inflicted an untold amount of pain and suffering on so many lives, surrendered at the very first sign that he himself was to encounter any sort of physical discomfort.
And so, realizing that the officer wasn't going to shoot you, what did you do at that point?
I realized I had no choice but to get on the ground because I was probably going to be tackled anyways or tased, and if I'm going to live, I'd rather not encounter physically a painful experience, so I decided I have no choice but to admit defeat at that point.
Right, okay. And so when you say admit defeat, what did you do?
I got on the ground.
Okay. That's quite an experience. That is quite a...
Not the usual everyday experience.
No, it's not. Did I miss anything?
I believe that's everything.
Alec, I thank you for talking to me. I really do. I really do. I really appreciate that. You've given me some insight. And,
I appreciate it, too.
How are you feeling right now?
I'm feeling good.
Okay.
Alec Manassian's trial date is set for February 3rd, 2020.